HR essentials. Let's talk about interviewing candidates, hiring and firing employees, and payrolls and benefits. Payroll and benefits. The most surprisingly hard thing of running a business for me is recruiting and then identifying good talent people to hire. It is very, very challenging. It is very, very difficult. And I've interviewed and now hired 100 plus people. I've sat through hundreds of interviews. I honestly haven't been on many interviews on the opposite side because, again, I've never really tried to apply for a job. But I can tell you from the side of somebody looking to hire somebody, it can be, it's honestly very hard just in the interview process to really know what somebody's ultimately like. And the absolute best thing to do is talk to somebody that you know and trust about what that person's work experience was like. Until you're in the trenches working with somebody, it's very hard to know what they're like. But I will give you both a series of red flags that I see in the hiring process and things that I do. So I've got a couple of questions that I always ask when I'm interviewing a candidate. To start off with, I always ask, what's the ideal position that you're looking for? Because I want to hear in their own words what the job there is looking for. And honestly, if they describe something that's not anything like what we have, which you'd be surprised how many times that happens, I immediately know, hey, this is kind of a red flag here. I ask them what they know about our company, and there I'm testing to see how prepared they are about what they know about Docstoc. And there's so much information about the company. If they come in and they don't know the basics, then I know that this is someone's not taking this seriously, and I'm not that interested in keep talking about them. I always ask them, what do they do better than anything else? There I'm trying to understand how they self-identify their strengths. I ask them, what are they weak at? What can they improve on? But I ask them in a slightly different way, because I think that's kind of a boilerplate way to ask that question. What I do is I say, if I talk to 10 people that you worked with before, and they told me all the great, wonderful things about you, but then I ask them to tell me what things about you bothered them and what things they didn't like, what would they say? And just by doing that little semantic trick of having that third person have to answer that question to make them think what somebody else would say, I find the candidates tend to be a little bit more open and honest. Because if you ask somebody, what are your own weaks and areas to improve, they either have a hard time self-identifying or they don't want to say it in the first person. But it's if you ask somebody, hey, what's a complaint or what's feedback that you've got from a previous manager on area that you need to improve, everybody's gotten feedback from somebody they've worked with, whether it's their peer or somebody that they work for, of saying, hey, we'd really like to see you get better here. And so I find that it's easier for them to then relay that feedback on. If somebody can't self-identify areas of weakness, I'm really not too apt to want to work with them. I never expect that somebody doesn't, it's not a trick question. I'm not looking for a reason not to hire somebody. By the time somebody gets to my office, I'm hoping that it works out. I'm hoping that I want to extend the offer to them. Otherwise, they never get to my office in the first place. So I'm not trying to find a reason not to hire somebody. And I think that question trips a lot of people up. What I'm really looking for, that I think most people are who ask that question, is how self-aware are you and how transparent are you willing to be about the areas that you know that you have to improve? And if I hear some BS answer like, oh, my problem is that I just work too hard or I care too much, I'm like, wow, that is a problem, isn't it? But what else? And I just keep asking the question again and again and again until I get them, I think, to answer in a way that's a little bit more truthful. The area that I'll bring up on the red flags in the hiring process is the following. Is if somebody's not prepared, if I get even the slightest inkling that anything they're saying is not truthful, or if in any way they come off as pompous or arrogant or just not a good person, it's a one strike rule. It's it's done. The amount of time, energy, and effort that you will spend trying to improve an employee, trying to improve somebody that you work with, is so detrimental to the business. I've typically found out that, at least from my experience, somebody either has a set of qualities that you're looking for and you can keep mentoring and grow them and help them be even better, or they don't, and in the cases that they don't, you almost never turn it around once you bring them into the business. One of the most surprising things to me is that as I get more and more experience in different business situations, I typically find that I just need to trust my instincts more and more. Really. And I'll give you an example. Just very, you know, openly and candidly, and there's a bunch of people in our office that are here, and I'm sure they can attest to it. During the day, there's a certain intensity I like to work with. At least for me personally, while I work on a lot of different things, I'm not someone that likes to commingle my personal day with my working day. When I'm working, I like to put everything I have into it, go as fast and as hard, and then when I'm done working, I, you know, 50% turn off my brain and enjoy my personal life, and 50% still always thinking about work. But that's because I'm a co-founder, I'm a business owner, and none of us ever get to turn off our brain. But when I first started, I noticed that not everyone liked to work at that same intensity level as myself. And I questioned, like, hey, is that an issue that I have that I've got to improve? Do I need to be more okay with people having lots of different working styles and doing lots of different things, especially as the organization gets bigger? And that was some advice I got from folks. And I can tell you, after 6 years, the answer I've come to is no, I'm not okay with that. And more experience has just confirmed for me that I like being in an organization. I think our organization will be successful when it's really high-performing people that love what they're doing, that come into work and are there because of multiple choices they can be there. I can tell you, pretty much every single person at our company is there not because they need to be there to make a living. They could go work at any number of jobs because that company affords them an opportunity to do something that is unique and different that they couldn't find in other places. So they could find other jobs, they could start their own company. And if they're not super engaged and loving what they're doing, then over time, I just know it's not a right fit. And I found in the past that I would doubt myself and say, oh, well, you know, people work differently. This person's not an owner of a business. But it has nothing to do with whether you're an owner of a business or not. If you don't take a tremendous amount of pride in your work and in what you do, and you at every moment want to do the very best job of it, that's actually not a standard you need to compromise on, because there are enough people that work that way. It's not the majority of people. It really genuinely isn't. Most people aren't driven by, I think, wanting to just do the absolute best job always. A lot of folks just want to, you know, have something that's kind of mentally stimulating and gives them a chance to make some money, and they get to enjoy their life, and they've got some good work-life balance. And that's totally fine and fair. And I think for a lot of jobs and a lot of companies and a lot of positions, that may be enough or more than enough than what you need. But for my personality and for the kind of business that we have, where there's consistent pressure to keep growing, because that's what we're going for, is a liquidity event. I mean, if I was running the business for a profit, it may not be as much of a big of a deal. I would just make sure that we hit certain profit targets every year. And as long as we get to that, then it'd be fine. And in our case, it's a never-ending charge until this business gets sold or until we go public. And so I just enjoy working at a specific level of intensity, and I know that I need to have a team around me. And that's something that for a long time I doubted. I said, well, should that be the case? Is that all right? Should I change my standards? And again, with more experience, I found that's no. And when I've worked with candidates that, you know, I've made exceptions for, I usually tended to find that I regret it. And a lot of being a business owner is learning to just really trust your own instincts and to trust your own inner voice. And as I was saying before, the reason that we doubt ourselves is because we a lot of times say, well, I've never been in business before. But being in business is really no different than being a good husband or wife or parent or friend. It's not this magical other process. You have to understand people's needs. You have to build and lead teams. You have to be able to create an exchange of value. It's not like it's this process that exists separate of everything else in our entire existence. And so it also goes in, and especially on the HR side of it, you have to be willing to step into the leadership role. It was a kind of unnerving thing for me, especially in this business with the number of employees that we had, to first accept that role of being the boss. And being the boss doesn't mean you get to tell people what to do all the time. That's ultimately going to be a recipe for just getting a lot of people that work for you not to like you. What it means is to set a clear vision of what needs to get done, to recognize the most important things that need to get done in your business, to lead by example, to do the thing, whatever you're gonna ask somebody else to do, be willing to do it yourself or have done it in the past, and then be able to communicate clearly and lead to the team of, hey, here's how we're all gonna move towards this end point and objective that we're trying to get to, and here's how you're an important part of the process, and here's how what you're doing is helping us get there. And that's the role that you need to step into, and a lot of the trick of starting a business once you get going is learning just to trust your own instincts. And more times than not, you will find that with more experience, you learn to just come back and trust your own instincts on the decisions you would and wouldn't make. And I often find that when people come to me for advice, they're not looking so much to be told what to do as they are just for somebody to confirm what they already plan to do, right?